Thank you very much for giving me the kind invitation. When I first received the invitation from my friend Patrick Webb and Shweta, I thought about what am I going to present. Then I thought that I should talk about something that is worrying me a lot. And I'm sure that that is worrying you too, which is today, as we talk about nutrition and food security, we see that there are lots of problems. Almost the entire developing world is plagued with problems of food insecurity and undernutrition. So what happens in future? Do we ever think about it? So that is what I am going to talk to you about today. And much of it will be personal reflections. And bear with me, much of it will be real provocative. So this is what I will do. Over the next 20 minutes, I'll talk about the burden of undernutrition and food insecurity in Bangladesh. You might question why I have decided to select Bangladesh. One, it is my own country, and I'm confident talking about Bangladesh. Two, we are now sitting in Nepal, and Bangladesh and Nepal are very close. And there are similarities and dissimilarities. The similarity is that Bangladesh and Nepal have the same area, the same size, okay? But look at the population. We have a population that is 6 times that of Nepal. That's the dissimilarity. Other things seem to be very similar. Then I'll talk about what are the factors responsible for the burden of undernutrition in countries like Bangladesh. What happens in 2050? Again, the question, why I have decided to select 2050? Because today in Bangladesh, we have a population of about 160 million plus. Plus means we never know what it is going to be. Is it very close to 200 million? We don't know. But then in 2050, it has been postulated that the population is going to stabilize at around 200 million. It is definitely going to be more than 200 million. So that's why I thought that 2050 would be a very good year to talk about. And finally, what we need to do. Is it a doomsday prediction that I will giving to you? No. We need to think about realistically what we can do to save for the future. So before I move on, let me share with you. Many of you are nutritionists, but maybe you have not worked with children who are really suffering from malnutrition. In this slide, you can see 3 panels. On the left, we have 2 boys, boys of the same age, 7 years, and you can see clearly that one is very stunted. In the middle, I had the very good fortune of treating this very unfortunate child with severe acute malnutrition. And look at the face of the mother. She herself suffers from undernutrition. On the right side, we have a child with underweight. And all these manifestations, the phenotypes of malnutrition, are very common not only in Bangladesh, but in also other countries of the developing world. So in Asia, compared to Africa, we have the hub of malnutrition. And it has been estimated that 34 million children in Asia under the age of 5 years, they are suffering from what we call acute malnutrition or wasting. And of them, about 12 million, they are suffering from the very moribund condition of severe acute malnutrition, which is a killer disease. If you don't treat a child with severe acute malnutrition, the likelihood of him or her dying from this condition is 14 times compared to that of a healthy peer. And look at what we have in Africa. The figures are much lower, 14 million and 4.3 million. So yes, the hub of malnutrition as we see today is not in Africa, but in Asia. And most of it is, unfortunately, is in South Asian countries. So this is what we have today in Bangladesh, the trends over the last 1.5 decades. Stunting, yes, there has been a considerable improvement. From 51%, we have come down to 36%. Underweight, from 43% to 33%. But look at wasting in the middle. Almost no movement. This has remained stagnated. So even though Bangladesh has done pretty well in controlling malnutrition, 33%, one third of all children under the age of 5 years, they are still suffering from malnutrition, one kind or other. So the World Health Assembly recently has come up with targets for 2025, and you can see the indicators: stunting, wasting, overweight, anemia, and exclusive breastfeeding. And I want you to focus on two countries: Bangladesh, where we have a red flag for wasting, anemia, as well as exclusive breastfeeding. And for Nepal also, we have red flags for the same indicators. At the same time, we have a yellow flag, which means it is on course, but there is a risk for overweight. So this is the condition that prevails in South Asian countries today. So why, the question is, why do we have such a huge burden of malnutrition? And to me, the three very important factors, particularly in the context of my country, Bangladesh, happen to be population, and then infections that come out, emanate from poor water sanitation and hygiene. And thirdly, and very important, which you have been discussing over the last several days, food insecurity. And I will touch on them briefly. So population density, this is the 2016 map of population, and you can see Bangladesh, a very tiny black speck, you know, denoted by this arrowhead. And you can see it's black because the population density is between 1,500 to 9,000 persons per square kilometer. In fact, with more than 1,300 persons per square kilometer, Bangladesh happens to have the greatest population density among the nations, not counting the city-states. And this has implications. Implications in the sense that, you know, if you go to Dhaka, which is a chaotic city, by the way, we have about 27% of the entire population living in urban areas. So we are not talking about unplanned urbanization. About 30% of Dhaka city, unfortunately, lives in slum settlements. And in fact, Dhaka is the fastest growing city. If you go to the top of the BRAC headquarters in the middle of Dhaka city, you will come across this largest, one of the largest slum settlements in Dhaka cities. Why did I show you this? I showed you because this has implications for both health and nutrition. This is a photograph of the inside of the intestines of a young child, okay? On the right side, you see that of a healthy child. You know, if you look at the biopsy taken from the small intestine with a microscope, you will see this beautiful finger-like slender projections from the intestinal mucosa. We call it villi. And through these villi, we actually absorb all our nutrients. But when this child is repeatedly exposed to pathogenic microorganisms, bacteria, and this happens because of poor water, poor sanitation, poor hygiene, perhaps all related with this huge population, the bacteria then colonize the small intestine, okay? And when they do this, they disrupt the entire architecture of the small intestine. And you can see, instead of the finger-like projections, you have blunted villi. And when this happens, the child suffers from malabsorption and ultimately suffers from malnutrition. This condition is called environmental enteropathy, and today it is believed that 40% of the entire stunting population in the world, 165 million, can be attributed to environmental enteropathy. So what is environmental enteropathy? When a child is subjected to poor sanitation and hygiene, there is fecal contamination of the environment, okay? So after ingestion, the bacteria then go into the system of the child, and as I showed in my previous slide, it disrupts the entire architecture of the villi in the small intestine. And this leads to, you know, problems. When you give an oral vaccine, like for example, a rotavirus vaccine, the child does not react properly. And more importantly, there is malabsorption and finally malnutrition. That's why environmental enteropathy has become so important over the last 5 years or so. We recently analyzed the data of more than 10,000 children under the age of 5 years to look for an association between socioeconomic status, water sanitation hygiene, as well as wasting. We took wasting because with stunting, there is already some indication that these work very well. But we were not sure about how it acted on acute malnutrition. And we used a very commonly used statistical model called structural equation model. So I don't want you to go through the details of this slide, but suffice it to say that socioeconomic status had a very strong positive association with wasting, acute malnutrition, and so did water, sanitation, and hygiene. And this study actually proves that if you have a child living in poor sanitation, water, and hygiene conditions, the likelihood of wasting or acute malnutrition is pretty high. So from water, sanitation, and hygiene, from population, let me now move to food insecurity. And this is the food poverty or food insecurity map of Bangladesh that was published in 2010. So we talk about food poverty as being incapable of, you know, affording the cost of a food basket of about 2100 kilocalories per person per day. So we have two lines, and I am sure that you are aware of these two lines. One is the upper poverty line that represents the moderately poor households whose food expense is at the level of the food poverty line, the 2100 kilocalories per kilo per day. Based on that definition, Bangladesh currently has about 32% of all households which are moderately poor, and in other words, moderately food insecure. On the other hand, if we have the lower poverty line, then this represents the extreme poor households whose total expenditures, not just the food expenditure, the total expenditure is at the level of the food poverty line. And based on that definition, as many as 18% of all households in Bangladesh are extremely poor or extremely food insecure. So perhaps because of that food insecurity problem, we have, and this is according to the DHS survey published in 2014, as many, only 23% of under two children, they are being fed as per standards of acceptable feeding practices. Only 23%. This should be as high as 80%, but in Bangladesh, only 23% of under two children are being fed according to standard complementary feeding practices. Perhaps this is another reason for the widespread malnutrition that we see. Prices of food are getting pricier. And this is not old, this is pretty recent, you know, 9th May, published in the Daily Star, when we saw that the price of food ingredients, they became pricier just within a week, a 22% increase in the overall, you know, price of foods. Affordability, you know, the affordability domain of food security is very important here. Unfortunately, and sadly so, Bangladesh has been ravaged by two flash floods this year, okay? And this has occurred in an area which is considered to be the, you know, food basket of the country. And when I saw this photograph, you know, I became so sad. Here we have an elderly person who is trying to salvage whatever paddy, unripe paddy that he could find from beneath the waters, from the fields that went under the water during the flood. So calamities, natural calamities, are very important in a country like Bangladesh. So as I said that, you know, the factors responsible for undernutrition in a country like Bangladesh, you know, they range from high population density, environmental enteropathy, low birth weight, low rates of exclusive breastfeeding, frequent illnesses, and natural calamities. So what are the nutrition interventions? How do we take care of this condition now? Back in 2008, when we were working for the Lancet Nutrition Series, we came up with a basket of nutrition interventions, okay? And here there are 10 interventions for optimal maternal nutrition during pregnancy, infant and young child feeding, micronutrient supplementation in children at risk, and then finally management of acute malnutrition. From a modeling exercise, we also found out that if you scale up all these 10 interventions, 70% or 80%, you reduce mortality among children, 60%. But what happens to stunting? Stunting is reduced by only 20%, one-fifth. So the question is, what then happens to the rest? How do we take care of the rest of the stunting? And this is possible if we combine the nutrition-specific interventions that I spoke about in my previous slide with these interventions, which are known as nutrition-sensitive interventions. They are nutrition-sensitive because they strike at the determinants of malnutrition. For example, food security, women's empowerment, water sanitation and hygiene, child protection, and this time we also have included family planning services. So, my last question, if the present is not good for a country like Bangladesh, what is it like in the future, in 2050? So, this is a very interesting paper published recently based on the data from Bangladesh. What they have done, they have divided the agricultural land of Bangladesh into six scenarios in 2050. And you can see in 2050, there would be a general decrease in arable land. Today, even as I speak to you, the amount of agricultural land, arable land, is reducing at the rate of 1% every year. Then we have declining groundwater in the north of the country, cropping of fallow land in winter in the south, effect of sea level rise. Bangladesh is considered to be one of the worst affected countries. And then increased cropping intensity, and finally, a larger share of cash crop. All these lead to a very disappointing picture. For example, if we consider F, we will have a 50% decrease in boro rice cropping. And boro happens to be the most important, most significant rice crop in the country. And we are dependent on that. So again, based on these scenarios, what was done was to look at self-sufficiency ratios for all the food grains. By self-sufficiency, we mean the consumption of a food grain divided by the production. If it is one or more, it means good. The country is self-sufficient. If it is less than one, then it means that you are doing bad. So you can see that in 2010, for rice, we had a self-sufficiency ratio of 1.09. And compared to that, in 2050, for all the grains, the self-sufficiency ratios are less than one. Meaning that in the future, a country like Bangladesh, with its current emphasis on agriculture, will have really a tough time in feeding the huge population. And just not cereals, look at livestock. The livestock economy of Bangladesh has improved considerably, but even then, it doesn't look promising because today we have a substantial deficiency of both of milk, of meat and eggs. And you will all agree with me about the importance of all this animal source food in the nutrition of young children as well as women. So when we look at fish production, you can see that there has been a substantial increase in fish production, inland capture, as well as inland culture. One thing that has faltered, not increased substantially, is marine production. Perhaps for the future, this can be an important intervention to improve and increase upon. My last point that I would like to place before you is this research that we recently completed, and we are also placing a lot of efforts in that. And this is on microbiota. What is microbiota? In the intestines, in all our intestines, we have millions of bacteria. Only 20% of this bacteria can be cultured even in the best laboratory of the United States or England. The rest 80%, they are culture insensitive. You cannot detect. How do you detect them? You can detect only if you use very sophisticated, high throughput sequencing depending on DNA and RNA methods. So what we did recently, and this is very important, what we did recently, we looked at what the microbiota, this is known as microbiota. What we did was to look at the microbiota of the intestine of children suffering from severe acute malnutrition and compared it with children who are healthy but who are living in the same slum settlements of Dhaka. And this is what we found. Very colorful, three panels. One is very colorful, and this colorful panel represents the gut microbiota of healthy children who are residing in slum settlements of Dhaka. You can see a lot of colors, and these colors indicate a robust bacterial diversity, and most of these bacteria are helpful, they are beneficial for the growth of the child. On the other hand, the two black panels, these panels represent children with severe acute malnutrition who are either treated with a local diet, halwa and khichdi, or with what we know as ready-to-use therapeutic food. But in both cases, you can see that everything is black, meaning that the microbiota diversity is very poor. We have been talking about food diversity, and here now we have microbiota diversity. So there is almost no microbiota diversity. And when we consider the beneficial bacteria that should be in the intestine, these are also gone. So what we found was that children with severe acute malnutrition, they have immature microbiota. Based on these findings, which were published in Nature, we are now working to see how they affect the metabolic machinery of these children. We have also found that this is not a consequence of malnutrition. Rather, this immature microbiota is a cause of malnutrition in these children. We have also found out through further research that there are certain members of the local food that are beneficial. Beneficial in the sense that they can promote the growth of healthy bacteria in these intestines of children. So right at this moment, we are doing research how to combine this beneficial food with the beneficial microbiota. So they can jointly promote growth of children. So as I said that, you know, in this research, we have found that there are as many as 170 families of bacteria. Those were significantly diminished in children with severe acute malnutrition. So to conclude, ladies and gentlemen, countries including Bangladesh have substantially reduced undernutrition, yet there is need for further improvement. And my opinion is that these are all context specific, but in case of countries like Bangladesh, increasing population size, associated problems of water scarcity, poor hygiene and sanitation, and of course, food insecurity will be even greater threats in future. They are threats now, they will be even greater threats in the years to come. There are solutions, but the solutions to me are few. One is definitely we need to scale up nutrition specific as well as nutrition sensitive interventions. But on top of that, we need to control the population in countries where you need to do so, and also to improve water, sanitation and hygiene, which are so intricately connected with the nutritional status of children. And then we need to do research to increase the yield of staples, livestock and fisheries. Bangladesh is a classic example of research in improving the yield of crops. Rice production has improved dramatically, and we need to do a similar type of research to increase the yield of livestock, fisheries and other important vegetables. And finally, as I have shown in my previous slides, we need to use upstream research to increase the optimum utilization of food, for example, by harnessing the gut microbiota. And I'll stop here. Thank you very much for your hearing.